Welcome to the economic sessions. Ibu Siti, are you there? We will also have Pak Abdul Manan from Sungai Tohor Village and also Pak Darsono from PTRMU. While waiting for the speakers to join in, I just want to give you a brief information about how we run this session. Ibu Siti, who is going to share the markets of local product. This is very much on the economic sense of the local product, how she has been incubating those process and then help the local community to reach the market. And then the following session speaker is Abdul Manan, who is going to speak from his village in Sungai Tohor. He's speaking in Bahasa Indonesia, but I will be translating for you and give the questions in Bahasa Indonesia, but also translate it very briefly to you what my question is all about. So it will be quite tricky for the second speaker, but he will offer to us very interesting story of value chains for sagu palm. And Pak Darsono will be sharing with us his experience to develop the value chains in Katingan village with regard to his work in restoring peatland surrounded by cultivation or utilization zones that Marcel was talking about. Can we start with Ibu Siti Hamidah from Universitas Lambung Mangkurat in Banjarbaru? She is a head of the Department of Forestry, but helping a lot in the forest product development and also connect that with the markets, both locally and perhaps also nationally. So without further ado, Ibu Hamidah, I offer to you.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Daniel. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon for all participant and speaker. First of all, I would like to thank you for committee for inviting me in this webinar. Actually, I will give you a video about peatland condition in South Kalimantan, but the time it's very limited, so I will focus on my presentation with PPT. Okay, today I would like to share my idea about market for local products and livelihood of peatland dependent community and with title development of commercial product based on wetland crops to improve community welfare. In this presentation, I would like to focus on peatland. I think it will be better if I was allowed to speak in Bahasa Indonesia. I hope Mr. Daniel can help me to translate what I say. I'm sorry about this because my English is not good.
Your English is perfect. No worries.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Baik, saya mulai dengan bahasa Indonesia, Pak Daniel. Start dari ide kami, dari program kami di Universitas Lambung Mangkurat adalah berdasarkan kenyataan bahwa pada saat ini kondisi wetland pada umumnya ini dianggap sebagian orang masih menjadi wasteland gitu. Apakah memang benar demikian? Jika memang benar demikian, apa seharusnya yang kita lakukan? Nah, ini start dari program-program kami di universitas. Kemudian
so the University of Lambung Mangkurat is
Lambung
trying
Mangkurat.
To help to improve the understanding about the role of peatland, which is considered as wasteland. How this perception is changed. That's the role of the university to help the community and the society as a whole.
Okay. Di sisi lain, kita tahu bahwa pemerintah melalui Badan Restorasi Gambut telah melakukan kegiatan untuk restorasi gambut di mana ada tiga kegiatan, rewetting, revegetasi, dan revitalisasi, di mana tujuan akhirnya adalah bagaimana nanti agar kondisi ekosistem wetland ini tetap terjaga. Dan di sisi lain, mampu meningkatkan kesejahteraan dari masyarakat sekitarnya. Nah, oleh karena itu, apa yang bisa diperbuat oleh kami di universitas untuk mendukung program pemerintah ini adalah salah satunya adalah pengembangan produk-produk komersial berbasis tumbuhan lahan basah. Tujuan akhirnya nanti adalah untuk kesejahteraan masyarakat di sekitar area lahan basah.
Oke. Okay.
Nah,
can you stop there?
Belum, Prof.
I have to catch your message.
Okay.
Don't be too long. Okay, so the university is responding on the government program and trying to help and in trying to implement the peatland restoration with three activities related to revegetation, rewetting, and revitalization of the local economy. So university is actively engaged in that program by developing market of local products.
Universitas Lambung Mangkurat sendiri mempunyai visi-misi yang sama, itu dalam untuk menjadi universitas yang unggul dan terdepan dalam pengelolaan lahan basah. Nah, oleh karena itu salah satu yang kegiatan yang dilaksanakan adalah pengembangan produk-produk komersial berbasis riset, di mana Universitas Lambung Mangkurat ini mempunyai pusat unggulan IPTEK, Pusat Inovasi Teknologi Komersialisasi Manajemen Hutan dan Lahan Basah, yang fokus banyak melakukan riset-riset di lahan basah. Kemudian nanti hasil-hasil risetnya ini yang siap dihilirisasi ke industri nanti akan didampingi atau disambut oleh organisasi lain yaitu inkubator bisnis teknologi, di mana nanti riset-riset yang punya potensi untuk dikembangkan ke arah industri ini akan diberikan kepada tenan calon pengusaha, baik itu tenan-tenan yang berasal dari lingkup universitas, mahasiswa maupun alumni maupun tenan-tenan atau startup yang berasal dari masyarakat luar.
Okay. So in playing that role, the university is also establishing the incubator unit to help developing the market so that there is a chance for the producer and the buyers or consumer meet at this point. So that the product is tested in the incubation unit, and the university play that very role in connecting buyers and producer.
Okay. Kita mulai dari kenyataan seharusnya kita melihat tadi dari video yang saya tampilkan dari atas ini, kalau kita lihat secara nyata seperti inilah kondisi peatland di tempat kami di Kalimantan Selatan, baik yang terutama yang sudah terdegradasi, tinggal ada sekitar 4 jenis tanaman, yaitu galam, kelakai, teratai, dan purun tikus galam melalui kalikodendron, kemudian kelakai Stenocrina palustris, kemudian teratai nimpea, dan purun tikus. Nah, dari kenyataan inilah kami dari tim Universitas Lambung Mangkurat ingin mencoba bagaimana agar kiranya lahan ini tidak tergantikan dengan tanaman lain gitu, karena masyarakat sudah mulai melirik untuk menggantikan tanaman lain yang lebih menghasilkan. Nah, mau tidak mau kita harus punya usaha bagaimana caranya agar tanaman-tanaman ini bisa menjadi produk komersial atau lahan yang terlantar atau tertinggal ini menjadi lebih produktif.
Thank you. So the display is very clear and self-explaining. How this remnant or degraded peatland offers something that can be used or enhanced in terms of the market values. A number of species here are useful, and they can be processed, and there are markets for this vegetation in the degraded peatland. That's what the university is trying to promote.
Okay.
Two more minutes, Ibu.
Yeah. Untuk pengembangan tumbuhan-tumbuhan tersebut kita pilih karena berdasarkan fakta bahwa memang tumbuhan itu ada dan sangat tahan terhadap kondisi yang sangat ekstrim di akibat kebakaran, panas yang sangat tinggi, dan lain-lainnya. Kemudian juga kearifan lokal di mana banyak masyarakat menggantungkan hidupnya terhadap keberadaan tanaman-tanaman ini. Contoh kelakai ini bisa dimanfaatkan sebagai obat dan makanan yang dipercaya mengandung zat besi tinggi sehingga bisa untuk pengobatan anemia.
This is one of the important species that are very well known to improve the iron content of our blood to improve the health, especially mothers and those who have problem with blood count.
Nah, untuk pengembangan satu tanaman ini riset yang sangat panjang perlu sangat diperlukan, terutama bagaimana jika kita nanti ingin mengindustrialisasikan. Saat ini semua produk dari lahan basah ini masih mengandalkan pengusaha-pengusaha kecil karena memang apa? Karena bahan baku itu data ketersediaan baik kuantitas maupun kualitas belum tersedia. Bagaimana kita menyediakan bahan baku yang terstandar belum kita dapatkan, sehingga riset-riset ke arah sana harus kita lakukan terlebih dahulu.
Yeah, you can see again various product that can be utilized and have markets locally, but the universities add on their role not only to promote this product but also how to make this product to be sustainable in terms of supply, the raw material. So they also doing research on how to make this commercialized species in the future. So domestication is the key here. So last minute, Ibu, please.
Ini salah satu riset yang satu hanya untuk menyediakan tepung kelakai, riset yang sangat panjang dan berliku itu. Terkebetulan ini menjadi disertasi saya, barangkali nanti bisa kita, saya bisa mempunyai kolaborasi riset dengan pihak lain untuk satu tujuan penyediaan tepung kelakai yang terstandar untuk industri pangan.
This is Ibu Hamidah kind of work, this is her baby, because this is her research of his, her PhD project, so for those who are interested to look at how the kelakai product is being promoted from the top process producing, but also processing and also sustainability of product for the markets.
Diharapkan
your final,
dari,
okay. Final word, Ibu.
Okay.
Half a minute.
Okay. Maybe. Saya langsung saja bahwa untuk melakukan semua kegiatan itu, kita sejak awal sudah melibatkan masyarakat, baik sebelum kegiatan, saat kegiatan, maupun setelah kegiatan. Sehingga semua pendapat masyarakat itu kita gali terlebih dahulu.
Oke, thank you.
Kemudian, mungkin satu lagi. Ini yeah. Beberapa produk yang telah kita hasilkan dan telah kita anukan, beri pelatihan ke masyarakat dari produk-produk pangan, mulai dari biskuit, roti, mie, minuman, dan sebagainya. Pada intinya untuk membuat satu produk itu diperlukan bantuan dari kita, dari universitas, karena untuk bagaimana produk ini bisa ke arah industri yang lebih besar, pasti harus melalui riset. Jadi disitulah peran universitas adalah menghasilkan produk yang siap dihilirisasi ke industri. Kemudian, mungkin saya langsung saja ini yang produk-produk lainnya barangkali langsung ke kesimpulan bahwa untuk mengembangkan peluang pasar saat ini masih kecil untuk produk-produk lahan basah karena memang belum terstandarisasinya baik dari segi bahan baku maupun produk itu sendiri. Kemudian agar siap untuk diindustrialisasikan maka kita perlu menstandarisasi bahan baku tersebut melalui hasil-hasil riset. Kemudian keterlibatan masyarakat harus kita mulai sejak awal. Lalu ketika komersialisasi produk atau produk-produk komersial ini sudah menjadi barang industri nantinya, maka kita tentu saja akan mampu meningkatkan kesejahteraan rakyat, tetap menjaga kearifan budaya lokal serta menunjang pembangunan nasional dan internasional termasuk tujuan SDGs di dunia. Nah, Dari kami, tim kami, salah satu indikator untuk bagaimana keberhasilan restorasi gambut itu dari sisi ekonomi adalah berapa sih jumlah pengusaha yang dilahirkan dari produk-produk atau usaha berbasis produk-produk dari gambut gitu. Kemudian berapa jenis tanaman yang bisa dikembangkan, berapa berapa jumlah produk-produk yang beredar di pasaran untuk menunjang kesehatan, pangan, dan sebagainya. Kemudian berapa sedalam apa keterlibatan masyarakat itu dilibatkan dalam kegiatan tersebut. Satu lagi indikator ekonomi ini tidak bisa kita lepaskan dari indikator yang lain. Kalau misalnya pendapatan masyarakat itu meningkat karena restorasi gambut, apakah benar itu berdasarkan kenyataan bahwa kenaikan pendapatan itu dihasilkan memang dari bagaimana kita mengelola lahan gambut secara optimal, bukan dari produk lain atau tanaman lain yang diintroduce ke tempat lahan basah. Salah satu indikatornya adalah berapa banyak mungkin jumlah-jumlah desa wisata atau ekoturisme berbasis lahan basah, mungkin ada desa wisata berbasis kelakai, galam, okay, sagu, dan sebagainya.
Terima kasih, Ibu Amida. So in her concluding remark, she said that and underlined that economic indicator is an integral part of restoration of degraded peatland. So she proposed that these economic values and market values of the product coming out from peatland should be considered, and suddenly the income from those who are running this small and medium scale enterprise should be part of the assessment in understanding how successful is restoration. Terima kasih, Ibu. Thank you very much. Ibu Siti Hamidah from Lambung Mangkurat University. Our next speaker is Pak Abdul Manan. He is speaking from his village. So let me share his screen. I will be asking questions to Pak Manan, three questions in English for you and in Bahasa Indonesia for him. It's quite a tricky part to do now, but let me try my best. Pak Manan, are you there? Ada di sana, Pak Manan?
Ada. Selamat sore.
Selamat sore. Would you like to greet your participants? Here we have, I don't know how many of us here in the room. Pak Manan is speaking from Sungai Tohor. He's going to speak about sagu palm. And I'm going to ask first question to him about the situation of sagu palm in his village, where he is part of the local NGO who is promoting sustainable management of peatland by raising sagu palm as part of their local livelihood, as well as market and economic activities of the local people. Pak Manan, pertanyaan saya pertama, apakah Pak Manan bisa ceritakan kondisi sagu di desa Sungai Tohor?
Iya. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Perkenalkan dulu, nama saya Abdul Manan dari Desa Sungai Tohor, Kecamatan Tebing Tinggi Timur, Kabupaten Kepulauan Meranti, Riau. Pada sore hari ini saya akan coba menerjemahkan pertanyaan Bapak tadi, masalah sagu yang berada di Desa Sungai Tohor. Sagu yang berasal dari Sungai Tohor itu adalah sagu turun-temurun, di mana sagu yang identiknya di lahan gambut, di rawa gambut, dan sagu ini sangat sukar sekali dengan air yang tergenang di lahan gambut. Jadi kami masyarakat Sungai Tohor sangat mengantisipasi bahwa gambut takut kekeringan. Apabila terjadi kekeringan, gambut akan terjadi kebakaran. Sagu ini adalah sebagai alternatif ekonomi kami di Desa Sungai Tohor, kalau tidak ada sagu, mungkin ekonomi kami di Sungai Tohor sangat lemah sekali.
Terima kasih, jadi, Pak. Sagu saya ini, terjemahkan dulu ya. So, in Sungai Tohor Village, it's one of the island in Riau, kepulauan, the island of Meranti, Kepulauan Meranti. You can find sago palm, Metroxylon sp, many species there, but this is the most common species found in Sungai Tohor. And one of the most important thing about sagu is that they have to grow in a flooded area, flooded landscape. So it is very important to have the landscape wet. So if it is drained or dry, so they will have problem in terms of growth as well as susceptibility to fire. So village people in Sungai Tohor is very much concerned about re-wetting of peatland. Peatland should be wet so that they can run business and rely on their livelihood on sagu as their main staple food. Silakan lanjutkan Pak kalau ada satu dua poin lagi mengenai sagu di Sungai Tohor.
Sagu ini sangat lama sekali untuk pertumbuhan awal, bahwa sagu ini kalau ditanam itu dibudidayakan itu sampai 10 tahun baru bisa panen. Tetapi setelah 10 tahun dipanen, itu bisa setiap tahunnya dipanen. Dan ini akan diolah oleh masyarakat di Desa Sungai Tohor. Sampai 700 ton per bulan di Desa Sungai Tohor sagu basahnya.
Yeah. So the villagers in Sungai Tohor very much rely on the natural sagu, but they also start cultivating it. They plant it, replenish the degraded land, empty land by planting them. They have to wait for 10 years to produce harvestable trees. These are the logs that's been chopped into a shorter size like this. One tree can produce 10, whatever it was called, tiger unit. So this must be coming from at least two or three trees of this bunch of sagu palm stem. Silakan lanjutkan.
Sagu ini setelah ditebang akan dibawa ke kilang tradisional masyarakat di Desa Sungai Tohor, lebih kurang 14 kilang, untuk memproseskan atau memproduksikan dari batang sagu menjadi pati sagu, sagu basah, yang mana sagu ini dikelola menjadi tepung sagu basah yang belum murni, tapi masyarakat kami akan jual kepada penampung, akan dibawa ke Malaysia.
Terima kasih. So this is a process of kind of value chains from the stem to the starch, and they process it to flour. And sometimes it's very coarse and still a lot of dirt in there. So they try to improve the quality so that it is marketable. They sell it to Malaysia with a certain price. When it is processed or clean, they will improve the quality. They will have a better price. Another product is sugar palm or sugar from sago. Yang terakhir, Pak, saya mau bertanya, harapan apa yang Pak Adnan, Pak Manan dan kawan-kawan inginkan tentang campur tangan pihak luar? Mungkin perlu support, perlu pasar, perlu kebijakan yang lebih baik tentang sagu ini, khususnya untuk meningkatkan taraf hidup masyarakat. I'm asking about his expectation and his colleagues about improving the market and also quality of sagu that they are going to produce so that they can earn more than just producing a very coarse and rough product. Silakan, Pak.
Okay. dengan proses sagu ini tadi yang 700 ton itu adalah sagu basah, di mana sagu basah itu dengan harga 1.750 saat ini. Jadi kami dari masyarakat dengan nilai itu adalah rendah, bahwa ada lagi turunan-turunan sagu yang untuk peningkatan sagu yang lebih tinggi lagi. Seperti kita bisa dari proses sagu yang basah tadi akan menjadikan sagu yang grade yang apa yang bersih dengan harga lebih kurang Rp4.000, dan dari sagu sudah dibersihkan itu akan menjadikan harga tepung sagu lebih kurang Rp8.000 atau Rp7.000 per kilo. Dalam hal ini
harapan Bapak apa berikutnya?
Harapan saya kepada pemerintah, baik itu pemerintah daerah dan pemerintah pusat, bahwa sagu ini tolong diperhatikan dengan pemasaran yang baik, di mana pemerintah kita sekarang itu ada Pajale, mengapa tidak ada masuk sagu di dalam bantuan sosial, supaya membudidayakan sagu dan mempertahankan sagu ini sebagai kebakaran hutan dan lahan di wilayah Nusantara ini. Artinya di lahan gambut yang rawa, apabila tidak dipotensikan sagu, sehingga terjadi kebakaran lahan, dan ini membuat ekonomi masyarakat turun. Jadi harapan kami juga pada pemerintah daerah, bagaimana ada suatu peraturan di bansos itu, bantuan sosial, 30% harus memakaikan produk sagu, 70% silakan memakai beras atau jagung. Ini harapan kami, supaya bisa untuk membantu UMKM kami.
Baik, baik. Wah, jelas sekali, okay, menarik sekali. So in the value chain, say he is expecting that the value of sagu palm that their process can be improved. The grade, the lowest grade is about 1,750 rupiah, so about 1,700 rupiah, 1,000 rupiah, and 1,500 rupiah. That's very low grade. But if technology is involved, they can improve it to grade A, which the price is much, much better, about 7,000 or 8,000. So he is expecting that kind of technology to be introduced. And also in the policy perspective, the local community expecting that sagu can be part of the so-called bantuan sosial scheme, bansos scheme, so that sagu can be used as alternative for rice, so that the product can be purchased by the government to face the in time of famine or difficulties of getting food resources. Terima kasih Pak Manan. Very informative, sangat informatif informasi dari Sungai Tohor. Terima kasih banyak. Let's move to the next speaker, Pak Darsono Hartono, who is working with community at Katingan Village in the context of his company effort to restore and manage peatland, and they also have a kind of spillover activities in the surrounding villages. Darsono, time is yours.
Thank you, Pak Daniel. Good afternoon, everybody. I hope that we only have 15 minutes left, but I'm going to try to be as short as possible, and I'm going to start with sharing screen. Just want to make sure that everybody can see. So again, my name is Darsono Hartono. I'm the CEO of PT Rimba Makmur Utama, as mentioned. We are the project developers of the Katingan Mentaya project. Just to give you a small, short overview. So Katingan Mentaya project is the world largest carbon credit project registered today. It's located in Central Kalimantan. We're being certified by VCS. The project itself, it's in a two river system. One is the Katingan River and the other one is Mentaya River in Central Kalimantan. Just give you the idea. So it's about 157,000 hectares. We estimate that we have 8 million tons of carbon credit production per year. But I guess not today, I'm going to talk more focusing on the supply chain and the productivity. So the idea is, we as a project developers, we see that there's opportunity for us to mitigate climate change by, you know, basically conserving and restoring peatland. Second, to provide sustainable livelihood. And then finally, make profit for the company. When we mention about sustainable livelihood, we are looking into a what we call production protection model. You know, while we know that some of the, you know, majority of the area is still intact peatland, we believe that protection should be done, but it doesn't mean that we cannot produce. So what I'm going to share with you today is to really understand why we as a company can actually help to increase productivity to the communities. So one of the value chains that we believe in, we have to create alternative sustainable livelihood, you know, by providing expertise, technical assistance for farmers, microfinance, and access to market. I think the caveat is the only thing is you can be productive in a non-deforesting way. You cannot be productive by deforesting the forest, right? That's, therefore, I think the key is you have to have that environmental, you have that environmental sustainability goods produced. And we are happy to share some of the experience that we have. Ultimately, you know, as a project developers, we can work hand in hand with communities and creating a brand as well as a higher productivity and higher income for the communities. So I'll give you, when we look at Katingan Mentaya project, we have to look at the landscape. So when we started this project 13 years ago, we really have to understand what are the natural capital provided in the area, how are the community and social aspect of it, and how we as a private sector can work together with them. So outside our peatland, actually there lies a lot of coconut plantation that is owned by communities. You know, traditionally, these communities actually just harvest coconut, which is copra, or young coconut. I remember when I visited my first visit to this area, it's outside our concession area, it belongs to community. They came to me and said, Pak Darsono, can we do something about this coconut? Because right now we only produce a very low quality product. So I think with that, we start thinking, what can we do to help them? So, you know, I think we were looking and finally we realized that in a coconut plantation, you actually can produce coconut sugar. In this case, if some of you are familiar, Indonesia, we are big consumer of ketchup manis. And our ketchup manis, in this case, is 80% of coconut sugar. So therefore, we start looking into this and see how can we actually help communities and transform and change their productivity by just harvesting copra as well as coconut sugar into a higher value product. So therefore, we are, you know, providing training to farmers. But the problem is, it's not easy. Out of the 15,000 hectares of area of coconut plantation outside our concession, because this is not a tradition. This is a typical Javanese tradition, not people from Kalimantan. So I think this is to start is to really have to go, how can we go about and scaling this up? And I think as in terms of the, you know, what we do is we finally created and formed a coconut training center where we help the communities and help them to train them. Because for a tree to harvest coconut sugar on a daily basis, you have to climb the tree twice a day. And we, you know, some of these farmers are not climbers. So therefore we have this coconut training center and train them how to climb the trees and sap it, you know. And then in the meantime, we also are teaching them how after the sap, the production, we can actually help them cooking. You know, basically we make them into from a coconut sap and then turn it into a paste. You know, I think this is something that we as a company can work together with them organically. We train them, we increase their productivity, and then we actually help to sell the product themselves. So I think, you know, we, as a project developers, we have to look at value change as something that we understand what natural capital provided. And then you sort of like marriage it to what the market is demanding and how you can work together to create a product. So beside coconut sugar, you know, now we're getting into coconut palm. Basically, we get into coconut oil now, virgin oil, as well as even things like vanilla, as well as, you know, cashew and coffee. So I think the idea is to really understand and teach communities that there is a way to be productive. There is a way to create. Yes?
Shall we have time for participants to ask questions?
Sure. Yeah, we should do. So this is it. So I want to make sure that basically, you know, in a value change, what we have to understand, we look at how community produce, and we help them to be more productive. That's my I think that's the slide that I have, my last slide. Thank you so much, Pak Daniel.
Excellent. Very good ending. Ladies and gentlemen, participant, would you like to ask questions? We have 5 extra minutes.
And we have 9 minutes, I think.
9? Okay, 8 is right. Please. We have 45 people in the room, so if we can pick 1 or 2 questions for Ibu Hamida, Pak Adnan, Pak Manan, and Pak Darsono, that would be great. So we have issues related to market, issues related to improvement of productivity as well as quality of product, and also certainly the market chains and value chains, production chains or supply chains, and also value chains. Please.
Be happy to ask a question, if I may, Pa Daniel.
Marcel, go ahead.
Yeah, so a question to Pa Darsono. Do you, Pa Darsono, also see options to bring communities into kind of collaborative frameworks for working on carbon finance, where communities also outside of your concession could help restore peatlands and forests and as such create carbon credits that perhaps through your company could be marketed?
Pa Darsono,
thank you, Marcel, for such a great question. So for some of you who are not familiar with Katingan Mentaya project, our area is about 157,000 hectares. But in the buffer area, we still have about approximately 40 to 50,000 hectares that belongs to communities. So on a short answer to your question, Marcel, yes. We're actually right now in the process of working with communities to basically, work with them and create a collaborative plan and effort to help them get carbon credit in those areas. So, in the form of hutan desa, basically in a community forestry model. So we are working on this, and hopefully the next 2 years, you will hear something coming out, not only about the product of Katingan Mentaya project in terms of things like the virgin oil, as well as coconut sugar, but most likely that the community will be producing carbon credit with the collaboration with us. And this will be something that we want to show to the world, that we can work hand in hand with community as well and have that benefit of the carbon finance that we have been talking about. But of course, it's not easy to get certification, but with our experience, I'm very, very confident that we can actually help communities and get that certification for them as well. And we will do this not as a private sector that is taking profit, but actually we are willing to even subsidize the cost if needed to give full benefit to the communities.
Yeah, excellent. So with that, this year, Pak Darsono has been awarded a Social Innovator of the Year by the SWOP. Congratulations for that, Pak Darsono. Questions or clarification for Pak Manan or Ibu Siti Hamida? Please. This purun tikus has not been described a lot, but I heard this is very environmentally friendly product. So instead of using plastic straw, you can use purun tikus straw, which is, certainly degradable and sustainable product from peatland, especially in South Kalimantan. I've seen it in the market. Very nice.
Yeah, betul, Pak.
Betul,
Pak Daniel. Memang kalau untuk saat ini purun tikus itu sudah dikembangkan oleh masyarakat menjadi souvenir, tapi itu pun pangsa pasarnya masih kecil, belum luas. Jadi masih perlu kita bantu lagi untuk bagaimana improve inovasi agar nantinya pangsa pasar itu bisa meluas. Misalnya kita mengambil inisiatif dari produk-produk Cina, okay, bahwa ketika membuat mebler dan sebagainya itu bisa bisa diinovasi macam-macam, tidak
You need a social innovator like Pak Darsono. You should collaborate with him. And Pak Darsono, you can go across the border, work in South Kalimantan instead of East Kalimantan, Central Kalimantan. So this is an opportunity how to improve the product and also, providing access to market.
Certainly, Pak Dan. I think there's another question from Diana regarding the water level on the coconut plantation. So the coconut plantation is actually is not on peatland. It's actually on the dry. It's on the mineral soil. So it's really outside that that ecosystem. So and we have created a local brand called Mantaya Sweet. Right now, it's selling very well. So basically, all the profit from this product is being passed through the communities. As a project developers, we even subsidize in the early stage. But the good news is now they are, you know, the demands of the, this product are really, really good because we are doing everything organically, even though we don't get certification. The quality of the product is very good, even better from the people, the product they produce in Java, especially on the coconut sugar. So I think that's another thing that we finally, not only that can show communities that this will work, we actually give them more comfort as well as confidence that they can do this. Like this is working with a cooperative, we're working with the design, that there is a solution if we really want to work together. There is a path of sustainability on a peatland restoration if we work together.
And they are no longer loggers.
Yeah, thanks. I wanted to have a follow-up on that because I wonder if there you can use your experience from the coconut, which is not on a peatland, you know, to move over to a peatland product. I see a lot of communities sort of cutting the whole indigenous palm down and using it, you know, for sago, which is a beautiful product. Are there other ones that we can look at that don't involve, you know, taking the entire palm down because that's so resource intensive? Are there fruits like in Peru, they have this aguaje fruit, which has been very, it's very high in vitamin C and they're starting to sort of build a market around it. Do you have other peatland fruits or products that you would see could
this
create?
This is sago, create a, mm-hmm. sugar from sago. Maybe Darsono has.
I think we see one thing that we're experiencing now that we're doing is we're actually doing vanilla. People don't see vanilla to be growing in peatland. But the good thing about vanilla is you need tree, right? Basically, you will keep the tree alive and then you're gonna, so we are testing it on a big scale now. It's growing quite well. And vanilla, not only that it's, you know, it has a much higher value in terms of the price. The idea is to find a product that is also good for environment, that is not, you know, basically it's not a predator. It's, you know, in a way that you can work together. So I think we're testing. We're testing all this thing, but the idea is to get, the key, once you have that social capital, everything can be done. It's a matter of just getting it right.
And you can do coconut vanilla sugar.
Yes, everything too. Everything is possible.
Great, thanks.
Thank you, thank you very much. You? Yeah, we already have reached the time where we have to go back to our plenary room. But
boleh satu pertanyaan lagi, Pak?
Go ahead.
Okay. Mungkin saya mau nanya ke Pak Abdul Manan ya. Mereka kan tadi di sana itu mengalami masalah gimana caranya meningkatkan nilai produk ya Pak. Nah di sini kan juga ada Universitas Riau yang paling dekat di sana. Sudah sejauh apa Pak kira-kira Universitas Riau ini terlibat di desanya Pak Abdul Manan? Terima kasih.
Pak Manan, you have questions how University of Riau is involved in your village. Bagaimana UNRI dilibatkan Pak Manan?
Sampai saat ini UNRI hanya riset tentang sagu, tapi harapan saya sebagai akademis Riau itu banyak memperhatikan tentang produk turunan sagu, di mana saya lihat di akademis Riau belum ada lagi penelitian tentang sagu untuk pengembangan sagu di lahan gambut rawa. Hal ini membuat kita juga sebagai anak Riau ya bertanya-tanya kepada akademis UNRI, sebab ada beberapa faktor yang perlu di riset. Pertama, masalah limbah sagu padat, ampas sagu itu kan dibuang oleh masyarakat ke sungai atau di darat. Dalam hal ini belum ada lagi riset dari akademis. Kalau menurut kami masyarakat, saat ini kan bisa dibuat pupuk organik. Tapi kami tidak punya sumber daya manusia. Dan juga dari ampas sagu itu bisa bikin batako, tapi kami kan belum lagi dapat bimbingan-bimbingan dari akademis. Kami harap Menteri bisa turun satu tim untuk Sungai Tohor untuk penelitian limbah sagu.
Ya, saya ringkas dalam bahasa Inggris. So, academicians are doing research, but they are also challenged to do more on the development aspect, especially from Rio University, who is the think tank of the region. Think of those waste that is produced from the processing of sagu. A lot of things can be done with regard to the waste, be it liquid waste as well as the solid waste. The local community have tried, but certainly need a lot of support from the academic and practical point of view, and certainly market. Any other comments or questions before we are dragged to the main room? No?
Daniel, mungkin saya bisa menambahkan sedikit Pak Daniel untuk yang sagu tadi. Kebetulan kami di Universitas Lambung Mangkurat dari program BRG tahun 2017 kemarin juga telah mengembangkan roti rendah kalori berbahan sagu. Cuma masalahnya memang kita mencari komposisi yang sesuai dari segi rasa, tekstur, penampakan terhadap khasiat untuk rendah kalori, di mana tujuan roti ini adalah untuk orang-orang yang diabetes dan orang-orang yang sedang diet diet rendah kalori. Tetapi memang kelemahan sagu ini adalah dia tidak tahan lama ketika dibuat, itu dia cepat mengeras. Jadi riset-riset kami adalah mencari komposisi gimana supaya tekstur roti itu tetap terjaga kekenyalannya, tetapi manfaat untuk diet rendah kalori tadi tetap terjaga. Itu sudah kita dapatkan di Lambung Mangkurat, Pak. Ini sudah diajukan patennya, mungkin dalam satu tahun ini sedang bisa keluar patennya.
Demikian. Akademis.
Yeah, so in Lambung Mangkurat University in South Kalimantan, they've been trying to test the quality of flour from sagu, because this is low calorie with low GI index, and it's good for those having diabetes, and also trying to use the product for alternative consumption. But the problem is that the storage problem, they can be perish quite quickly. So, but technology can help. And Lambung Mangkurat University has registered their patent to get this process sagu with high quality. So perhaps you can also share to colleagues in Rio University, Bu Hamidah. So we will have Pak Haris, who is going to close this session. He is a deputy of BRG, but he is from Rio University. Maybe this kind of conversation can be conveyed to him so that, you know, the impacts of activities in one place can be affecting other places with similar challenges and opportunities. Thank you very much for your additional information.